Live from the Civic Media World Headquarters in Madison, Wisconsin, it's the Todd Albaugh Show. And now, pursuing truth wherever it may lead, here's your host, Todd Albaugh.
Good morning across the Civic Media Radio Network and streaming worldwide on the Civic Media app. I'm Todd Albaugh. It is Friday, the 28th of April, 2023. Along with Mr. Aaron Zommers, our producer and engineer, glad to have you in. The end of the work week, the end of the school week for many, although some who are work of the weekend still have to work. But for us, Mr. Zommers, thankfully, we are done after today.
Yep, we'll be done. I will go home, probably take a nap. That's where I'm at this morning.
you're a little tired this morning, and you said it just hit you.
Yeah, as we were talking about before the show started, yeah. I was perfectly fine all morning. I woke up, felt great, all good to go, nice and awake. And then maybe 15 minutes ago now, I just felt like I got hit by a truck.
2 hours of Pat quite low and he's gone. That was all he could take.
Now I have a nice crisp can of Coca-Cola to try and wake myself up a little.
Very good. Have a Coke and a smile, Mr. Zommers. That's exactly what you need. Well, whatever you're doing this morning, whether you're grabbing a Coke or grabbing a cup of your favorite coffee, like I have Wonder State in my Milwaukee Brewers cup this morning. There you are, a little Wonder State, a little organic Columbia this morning, as a matter of fact. And speaking of the Brewers, we are giving away this morning at hour number two in the 9 o'clock hour to... Not two, but four. A packet of four. You and three of your favorite friends, family, or a person you find on the street. That could be interesting. Just say, hey, want to go to a game? It could turn out great. Maybe that's a bit we'll do later on this summer. We'll just go on the street and say, hey, do you want to go to a Brewers game? And we'll have no idea what we're getting into.
And you know what? As long as you go up to them holding a microphone, it'll right? look like you're official.
Yeah.
And then they might actually believe you.
I'm going to write that down for Mr. Paul's. Hey, do you want to go to a Brewers game? That might be fun. It could be completely disastrous as well, but it could be fun.
It could be.
Anyway, we're going to give away four tickets to the Milwaukee Brewers game for this Sunday, the 30th of April. Let's see. April, June, and November, all the rest. So, yeah, you know, 30 days in April, right? 30 days has September, April, June, and November. So the last day of the month. April on Sunday. Game time is set for 1:10 p.m. So it's fantastic for those of you listening, even up in Amory. So if you want to drive down on Sunday for a Brewers game or from Wausau or from Richland Center or any place that you're listening this morning, as long as you can get there, you have to have a cell phone or a smartphone because we have to email you the tickets. They're all paperless now. So you have to have the ability to go, number one, to be able to attend the game on Sunday at 1:10. And then also you have to be able to have the tickets mailed to you, emailed electronically, emailed to you. And you cannot have won within the last month. So please use the honor system there. And if you've already won, we appreciate it. But you cannot have won in the last month. So we will give away a pack of four Milwaukee Brewer tickets for this Sunday, April 30th. 1:10 first pitch on Sunday against the Los Angeles Angels at Anaheim. That's a mouthful. But yes, the LA Angels are in town. They're playing tonight, as a matter of fact, at AmFam Park. 7:10 tonight. You can be heard on WRCE in Richland Center. AM 1450 at FM 107.7. And also over at Oshkosh at WISS. What's the, I want to say Lake Air Support. That's for Amory.
It's Air Support. Lake Air is Amory, and Air Support is Oshkosh.
I've combined the two channels. The branding folks are going crazy. Todd, get it straight. So Air Support, Oshkosh Air Support, on the Big 1100 AM over a huge signal. You can hear it at Luke Mather's house in Sub Prairie, as well as my dad's stepmom's house in Shawano. So all over the eastern side of the state, Oshkosh Air Support, the Big AM 1100 or WRCE, AM 1450 in Richland Center and FM 107.7, all season long, Milwaukee Brewers baseball. We're going to give away those tickets. And let me just say once again, because we're not making a big enough deal, I'm not making a big enough deal about this. These are just not your average run-of-the-mill Brewer seats. And there's nothing wrong with those. But if you've ever wanted, if you ever sat at a ballpark and looked up where the skyboxes are, and then those seats kind of around the skyboxes, you're like, wow, that'd be really cool to be up there. this is where those seats are at. You will be on the club level. There is a special VIP entrance you have to go through. You'll have your own concession stand. If you don't want to sit in the seats the entire time, there's a lounge with TVs all over, a little gift shop for you, private entryway into the club level area. You'll be right below the skyboxes. It is padded seats, great views of the Brewers dugout along the, you'll be sitting on the third base side, looking into the Brewers dugout and a great view of the entire stadium. These are wonderful seats. We're going to give them away in the 9 o'clock hour this morning. So be with us then. Coming up in this hour at 8:30, equally as spectacular, our bi-weekly guest, Mr. Bradie Ewing, former Wisconsin Badger football player, former NFL player, and timely indeed, as Mike Lucas would say, because the NFL draft kicked off last night. We will talk about the Milwaukee Brewers, the Green Bay Packers. Wouldn't it be fantastic if the Brewers pick somebody in the NFL draft? That'd be actually, I like that. No, we'll talk about the rather surprising pick of the Green Bay Packers coming up at the bottom of the hour as well with Brady. Also, Brady was at the a little spring practice for football, for Wisconsin football. He'll give us his reflections on that. And Coach Luke Fickell and Phil Longo and others. And also, we'll be talking a little bit about Aaron Rodgers going to the Jets. Not going to spend a lot of time on it, but just Brady's take on that whole thing since it's finally over, right? We're going to come back and also check the weather and the top news headlines, what you need to know for a Friday. Mr. Zomer's Board Game of the Week in hour number 3, and also it's Mimosa Friday, what we are thankful for. Stay with us, big show today. Your calls as well, the Todd Allball Show on Civic Media. The Todd Allball Show. It's now 8:15 on the Civic Media Radio Network. Glad to have you along on a Friday, April 28th, 2023. I would be remiss, Mr. Zomers, if I did not send out a thank you to, we'll do it officially as well in writing, but a thank you over the air to the Air National Guard, the 115th here in Madison, specifically Brigadier General David May, who he and his staff, Captain Peters and all the rest, did a great job of hosting us yesterday for our show on location at Truax Field. And wow, what a fantastic time that was.
Oh, absolutely. I am always impressed. Mm-hmm. Just by everything. Like, there's by the professionalism, but still the, there's still people. They're not like military robots, right, or something. Whereas, I don't know, sometimes some people expect that kind of thing. Mm-hmm. Or I know that I don't realize on a daily basis just how much people like the Air National Guard do,
yeah,
every day.
Right. It's phenomenal when you see their dedication, their professionalism, their intelligence, their talent, their passion. It makes you feel better just being on the base out there. Pretty much any military base I've ever been on always makes me feel better just being around that environment and that spirit.
Also, like, they really do seem like a family.
Yeah, absolutely.
Whereas some branches of the military, that does not appear to be the case.
Right. Sometimes, some divisions, whatever. But yeah, no, they all seem to be genuinely supportive of one another. And we can be very proud as Wisconsinites to have an institution like the Wisconsin Air National Guard. And exciting to see the arrival of the new F-35s. And who knows? Maybe on a little later this summer, we'll do another event with them. We're talking about something like that. So we shall see. But thank you to the Wisconsin Air National Guard and Brigadier General David May for hosting us on location at Truax Field yesterday. Glad to be back in the studio today with Mr. Aaron Zomers and with you as well. Here is your weather forecast around the state of Wisconsin for this morning. Mostly cloudy, a high of 68 in Richland Center in southwest Wisconsin, WRCE. Mostly cloudy, showers likely tonight, a low of 40. Tomorrow, Saturday, showers likely and a high of 52. Up in Wausau, WXCO, Bull Falls Radio, partly sunny today. Beautiful day, a high of 65 in Wausau today. For tonight, partly cloudy, a low of 40. And then Saturday, showers likely and a high of 43. Up in Amory, not quite so nice. A little bit more of a chance of rain today. A high of 53, rain overnight and a low of 35. And tomorrow, more rain. And a high of 46 degrees. Kara Foster will be in in about 10, 15 minutes or so and give us the complete weather forecast detail for you from Weatherology, what you can expect through the weekend. I'll give you a preview, not quite so nice, but it's going to get better next weekend. So if you get through this weekend, and by next weekend, certainly going to be better. Big sports news last night. The NFL draft occurred. We'll be talking about it at the bottom of the hour with Bradie Ewing. But headline, the Green Bay Packers select an Iowa player, an edge rusher, Lucas Van Ness, with the number 13 overall pick in the NFL draft. It's interesting because he never had a start for Iowa. Was basically a backup player. Impressed Mike Gutekunst and the rest of the Green Bay Packers organization. So the Packers select Lucas Van Ness, an edge rusher out of Iowa, number 13 overall. The NFL draft continues today with the second round, and we'll be giving you on Monday some of the highlights or maybe the lowlights, the Packers picks over the weekend. Also, a cool story we'll talk about with Brady at 8:30. The Jets selected a player from played high school ball at Waukesha North, I believe. So a Wisconsin kid can you imagine that growing up in Wisconsin and playing, watching Aaron Rodgers on Sundays while you're in high school, and now you're going to get to play with him in New York? I mean, that's pretty spectacular. Here's April 8th, 2023. Former Vice President Mike Pence testified for more than 5 hours yesterday to a federal grand jury investigating the aftermath of the 2020 election and the actions of then-President Donald Trump and others. This marks the first time in modern history a vice president has been compelled to testify about the president he served beside. Pence was set to recount for the first time under oath his direct conversations with Trump leading up to the insurrection of the U.S. Capitol on January 6, 2021. A federal judge previously ruled Pence could also be compelled to recount conversations when Trump repeatedly pressured him unsuccessfully to block the 2020 election results. The Federal Reserve will release a report today on the findings from its investigation into what caused Silicon Valley Bank to collapse last month. Rondell Quarles, the former vice chair of supervision at the Fed, told organizations that he doesn't expect the report to uncover any smoking guns. However, new details could shed light on how the bank imploded and what, if anything that is, could have been done to prevent it. Quarles said the report will likely hint at or formally propose more restrictive banking regulations without outlining specifics. In particular, he thinks there'll be a lot of discussion around rolling back rules that allowed banks to the size of SVP to skirt certain capital liquidity requirements they've been subjected to in previous years. Immigration now. The Biden administration is bracing for a surge of migrants at the U.S.-Mexico border when a COVID-era border restriction known as Title 42 lifts this next month. On May 20th, when the coronavirus public health emergency ends, the restriction will expire, meaning border authorities will no longer be able to quickly expel certain migrants. Instead, authorities will have to return to decades-old protocols at a time of unprecedented mass migration in the Western Hemisphere. Behind the scenes, administration officials have been racing to set up new policies to stem the flow of migrants, but even with those put in place, officials recognize that they could face an overwhelming number of people. A senior Customs and Border Protection official told news agencies that the agency estimates several thousand migrants are already waiting in northern Mexico to cross the border. And again, for a little context, a little analysis here, this is something that happens every year. Some years are worse, quote-unquote, than others in terms of the number of people coming across the border. But this has happened under Republican administrations, including the Trump administration, happened under Democratic administrations, including the Obama administration. So don't be confused. This is not some new thing. It's just a matter of happening each and every year around this time. Made a little worse in terms of the amount of folks coming through so quickly. Worse in terms of the pressure it puts on the system because of so many folks being held back because of the COVID restrictions. But we shall see. A bacterial outbreak has caused 41 infections At a Seattle hospital, health officials announced this week numerous cases of a pneumonia bacteria at Virginia Mason Medical Center were reported since October, with the most recent confirmed case identified on April 3rd. It's a type of bacteria that lives in the intestines that can lead to illnesses in healthcare settings such as pneumonia and meningitis, as well as a bloodstream, wound, or surgical site infections, according to the CDC. Patients in a healthcare facility may be exposed to the bacteria through person-to-person contact through ventilators or catheters. The hospital said it is investigating the source of transmission and taking precautions to prevent additional cases. Twitter update now. 6 months after Elon Musk took control of Twitter, the future of the company and the platform have never been less certain. After acquiring the social media platform for $44 billion in late October, Musk reportedly now values Twitter at around $20 billion. And some analysts believe that estimate is likely high. Can you, can you imagine losing a $20 billion in a year? I mean, that's something.
I feel like I probably would because I'm not experienced. So that's exactly what he's doing. And yeah. He's hiring all the people who know, or he's firing all the people who know what they were doing. So yeah. It is basically effectively if I took over Twitter right now and thought I knew better than everyone else.
It's something. This story says additionally, Musk has laid off 80% of Twitter's staff and is allegedly failing to pay some of its bills, according to multiple lawsuits. This comes as Musk's primary growth strategy through an overhauled subscription strategy has resulted in much chaos, or chaos, and a limited number of actual subscriptions. Twitter has also lost several top advertisers and a number of users. Celebrities and media organizations have said they plan to leave. One of the latest corporations to ditch the platform is the Metropolitan Transportation Authority, North America's largest transportation network, serving millions of metro and bus passengers in New York and connecting states. I mean, we've said this before, I'm not going to get deep into it, but I use Twitter as a news curating service. News curating service. In other words, I follow credible things like, you know, CBS, CNN, ABC, MSNBC, you know, other Associated Press, Wisconsin State Journal, Milwaukee Journal Sentinel, WISP Politics, Recombobulation Area, things like that. Things I know I can trust. And so I like to keep up to date because we want to bring you news abreast of the news. And of course, for years, if you were a legit news organization or if you could be verified, quote unquote, there was a check mark, a blue check mark next to your name on your username on Twitter. That's why that way people knew that what that organization was saying was the truth. Well, now Elon Musk said, you know what? I'm going to want people to pay $8 a month for that. And the funny thing is, I did this for about 4 or 5 months last year before it was required. Because what you got with the blue check, and by the way, I subscribed for the $8. I did not get a blue check mark. I just did it because it allowed you to edit tweets. And because of my dyslexia and bad typing, sometimes I'll make a spelling error. I'm like, well, if I'm going to work for Civic Media, I should, you know, my tweets should be grammatically correct and not have misspellings. So I did it for 3 or 4 months, and I've since given it up. I'm not paying the $8 now. So a tweet here or there may have a misspelling. But the problem with this is now there are unscrupulous people who are downloading the pictures off the official Twitter, people's Twitter, news organizations, individuals, and making fake Twitter accounts. And so it's like you don't know what to believe. But the key is, if you followed someone before this and you know they're legit, just be careful if you follow new Twitter people. That's the key on Twitter. Anyway, we shall see what happens on that. Breaking news this morning, death toll from a Russian strike in Ukraine has risen to 16. At least 16 people now have been killed in a Russian missile strike across Ukraine today, with a wave of early morning attacks reported in several cities, including Kyiv. Ukraine's Minister of Internal Affairs said the missiles and drones were also shot down over the capital city in what authorities called the first missile attack on the Ukrainian capital in 51 days. We broke the news yesterday during the show, but Jerry Springer, the former Cincinnati mayor and longtime TV host whose tabloid talk show featured sparring couples, has died, according to a family spokesman. He was 79 years old. In 2010, Jerry Springer told CNN he did not mind being referred to as the grandfather of trash TV, as the Jerry Springer Show celebrated its 20th anniversary on the air. So there you go. The grandfather of trash TV, dead at the age of 79. Back with our weather forecast from Kara Foster. Also, Bradie Ewing on the sports scene across the country. Back after this, the Todd Allball Show on the Civic Media Radio Network.
Standing there on that lawn, discount shades, store-bought tan, flip-flops and cut-off jeans. Somewhere between that set and the sun, I'm on fire, I'm born to run. You looked at me and I was done, we're just getting started. I was saying,
welcome back to the Todd Allball Show. It's now 8:33 on a Friday, April 28th, 2023. Bradie Ewing will be joining us in just a moment to talk football, among other things. But first of all, we talked to our quarterback of weatherology. That is Kara Foster. And Kara, it looks like the team is going to face some adversity in terms of trying to find sunshine for the weekend.
Yeah, it's unfortunately going to be a very indoorsy type weekend, I would say. You know, maybe get some spring cleaning done on the sure. On the inside of your house or apartment or wherever you live. Not so much outside. It's not going to be good for that. So I'm sorry for those who, you know, maybe wanted to mow their lawn or like spruce up their gardens or something like that. Definitely not the time for that. But next week will be the time. So you will have time soon, I promise you guys.
Prepare now. Do the inside stuff this weekend. Now. And then next weekend we can have fun.
Yeah, go get your supplies. Yeah, run over to Home Depot or Lowe's or wherever you go and grab some, you know, grab your gardening stuff, get that ready. And then you'll be all prepared for next week. But yeah, today, tomorrow, and Sunday are a lot of the same. I mean, it's going to be kind of dreary out there. I know a lot of us have been waiting to just get outside, see some sunshine and warmer temperatures. Unfortunately, it's, you know, going to be pretty gloomy, but really good for movies too. Showers and thunderstorms today, cloudy 53. Fortunately, no winds for today and tomorrow. It's going to stay pretty calm out there. So it's going to be kind of nice, I would say, if you're kind of looking for that, you know, rain, kind of April rain shower vibe. It's going to be very calming. We'll see some shower, or for Amory, we're reaching 53. Same thing for Wausau. You could see some scattered showers today, but they're actually going to be a little bit lighter for today. They're going to see some sunshine, a high of 65, and then same in Richland Center, sunny and 68. Now, tonight is when everybody gets the showers. We are seeing showers continue into Amory, dip down to 35. Showers also continue into Wausau, dip down to 40. And then more rain showers likely into Richland Center, dip down to 40 there as well. Showers are likely everywhere Saturday. It's going to be very, very rainy no matter where you are in the state. Highs in the upper 40s, lower 50s. Showers still continue into Saturday night. That's when winds do kick in out of the north, gusting as high as at least 30 miles per hour. And we could see just a dash of snow flurries in there throughout the central and northern portions of the state. Doesn't seem like we'll see any accumulation. I don't think there is going to be anything out there. We're still going to be not quite reaching that freezing point, so we shouldn't have to worry too much about it. Rain and snow showers for the central and northern portions on Sunday, and then rain showers continue for the southern portion. Still breezy out there, so it's not going to be too nice to kind of stand in the rain if you wanted to. And then Monday, still kind of just seeing the rain showers move through. It's going to be much lighter, but the winds will still be sticking around, highs in the upper 40s, lower 50s still. We'll see that finally taper off Monday night. The winds will continue into Tuesday, which will be a good thing because we'll kind of need to dry out, right? We'll see some sunshine there, highs in lower 50s, even lower 60s maybe as we head into Tuesday. And then Wednesday is when it all turns. We're going to be in at least the 60s throughout the entirety of the state, more sunshine, no winds then. We'll have another chance for some rain Thursday, but as of right now, it's a little itty-bitty chance, and we'll be in the upper 60s by then. So it'll be much warmer, and we'll have a mixture of sunshine in there as well. So like I said, we'll just hold out for the weekend, spend some time inside, watch a movie, get some stuff done, check things off your list. And then as we go into next week, we can get outside and enjoy it a little bit more. I'm meteorologist Kara Foster.
All right, Kara, thank you very much. Have an outstanding weekend cleaning the inside, wherever you're doing, and enjoy a movie and some popcorn. We'll talk to you on Monday.
Yeah. All right. Catch you then.
Thanks, Kara. Take care. Bye-bye. We appreciate Kara Foster. We appreciate our next guest. As per usual, every other Friday, we are joined by Wisconsin Badger football player, four-year on the Badger football team, captain as well, and three-time Big Ten champion, also played for the Atlanta Falcons and Jacksonville Jaguars in the league, the NFL. Bradie Ewing joining us live over the phone from Richland Center. Mr. Ewing, how the heck are you?
I'm doing great.
That's good.
I'm bummed out to see the rain coming in. Hopefully we can get our youth soccer game in for the kiddos tomorrow, but
right.
All is well.
So here's the big thing I want. I don't want to forget it this time. Before we talk about anything else, I want to know, did you get your turkey? That's all I want to know.
I didn't, actually. I had a couple opportunities and actually called in two separate times on two separate mornings, but I don't know. I elected to pass this year and just enjoyed being out there and calling in, seeing the sunrise, and just passed a couple opportunities, which
nothing wrong with
but
that.
But it was good. I enjoyed being out there.
That's one of the things I love about turkey hunting, I think, more than anything else, is just being out there early, watching the sunrise, and then you don't talk to the deer. I mean, I know some people use the antlers and try to do all that, but I mean, you gotta try to communicate with the turkeys, and they seem to always want to communicate with me, but never stand still enough where I can get a good shot.
That's what I love about it. It's so interactive,
right?
And being able to hear them gobble when they wake up in the morning, hear the other birds start singing, see the sun come up if it's not raining, like Kara mentioned today. And I love it. I love it. It's so different than deer hunting, where you tend to just, sit and wait and take it all in. It's more interactive. And
oh yeah. And
it's getting a blast. I'm excited to get the kids out there too.
Yeah.
Getting to run around for turkey hunting, like deer hunting, sure, you can do a drive, but aside from that, you're just sitting there all day. But turkey hunting, you're calling, you hear them across the street, you can kind of figure out where they're going and try and get ahead of them and set up real quick.
And at Madison, you can actually call them across the street because they run across University Avenue. Bradie, one guy that some people would call a turkey, some people would call a star, Aaron Rodgers. He is finally gone. The deal is done after talking about this. It seems like Thanksgiving, but the Rodgers is gone to the Jets. It appears by most analysts, most people think the Packers got the better deal on this.
Yeah, I would tend to agree. There's some... most, like you said, think it was a good deal for the Packers. Some saying the Jets, made out really well. But I think it's a good deal for the Packers, assuming that, Jordan Love's ready to go and can, continue to develop in short order. Although I think it's been 3 years and this will be going on his fourth year. So hopefully he's ready to go. But to come away with, a little bit higher draft pick, adding some draft picks and some talent, through the draft in the coming years, I think it's a positive overall.
Yeah,
how about you, Todd?
No, I think so. I think it's a positive overall. I know that I was ready, and look, I don't begrudge Aaron Rodgers anything. I mean, he spent basically his entire career here. He helped win a Super Bowl. I think there were a couple other opportunities that weren't his fault. The Packers should have been in the Super Bowl, but they weren't. Look, I think he has. Who am I to judge? But, it seems to be he has some things going on in his personal life that have kind of distracted him and made him kind of get a little bit wacky in some terms, in terms of some of the things he's saying and doing. So, I hope he can go to New York. I hope he's happy. I hope he can be himself and just live his best life. And I hope that Jordan Love is spectacular and everybody can just go on and be happy. That's what I hope.
Well, right off into the sunset.
Right.
Do you know if they restructured his contract at all, or did the Jets pick up basically his existing contract?
I have not heard. That's a great question. I've been looking around. I have not heard that they restructured the money deal. So I'm assuming, unless it was some sort of non-disclosure thing, my guess is he's getting pretty close to the, as my granddad used to say, pretty near close to the $59 million. So he's going to make out okay.
He's doing all right.
Aaron's doing just fine. Thank you very much. But I know our colleague Krista Bray, Krista Bry on As Goes Wisconsin, noted yesterday that, you know, when he was introduced in New York, was it yesterday or whatever, suddenly there's the nice, cleanly shaved, nice haircut, very model-esque Aaron Rodgers. None of the kind of hippie...
I didn't see that.
Oh, yeah. None of the hippie-dippy ayahuasca, I'm going off for 5 days in the darkness, Aaron Rodgers. Oh, no. It was the clean, you know, model-esque Aaron Rodgers.
Starting fresh.
Yep, starting
you
fresh.
You never not that any of these people didn't know of Aaron Rodgers, but you never get a second chance to get a first impression.
Right?
My dad used to say.
Exactly. And I think that what's interesting is I had heard that Joe Namath had said that if Rodgers went to New York, that he would allow his number 12 jersey to be unretired. But yesterday when they held it up, Rodgers had number 8. So it appears he's going to wear 8.
Wow.
And he is not going
Flashback to college days, right?
Yeah, I believe so, right? So
I think so.
The old was Cal, right? He played for Cal, the Cal Bears?
Yep.
I believe. So,
great.
He says that's why he doesn't wear it when he was a big Badger fan. He'd go to a Badger basketball games during the NCAA tournament. He refused to wear red because of Stanford in the Pac-12. He says, I don't wear red.
It runs. The rivalry runs deep. I wonder if he would go speak to the Stanford, you know, like you're discussing with J.J. Watt.
Yes, right.
Is he going to talk to the other Big Ten teams for motivational speeches?
Not a chance.
Doesn't sound like it.
No, not a chance. he has higher priorities, I think, in his own mind,
yeah,
at least.
No doubt.
The draft happened yesterday, and I'll be honest with you, Brady, I watched about 10 minutes of it, if that, because I was watching, I'm hooked on this new show on CBS called So Help Me Todd. And it has nothing to do with the fact that my name is Todd. It's a great program called So Help Me Todd. So I was watching that last night. And then I also
check it out.
It's a great show. And then I also watched a little bit of the James Corden primetime goodbye special for The Late Late Show. Because, I mean, how the hell can you really give up? How can you pass up our Adele in carpool karaoke? I mean, you can't pass that up. So I watched that a little bit. And then I flipped over to the draft. But the Packers, Green Bay Packers, selected Iowa edge rusher Lucas Van Ness with a number 13 overall pick in the NFL draft. He is from Iowa. And it's a really, I'm reading a little bit about it in the Milwaukee Journal Sentinel today. Ryan Wood has a great profile. If you get a chance, go to the Milwaukee Journal Sentinel, Ryan Wood's profile. But this guy never started at Iowa. Never started a game.
Really?
Never started a game, but got picked number 13 in the first round. I mean, that's something, right? And a lot of Packer fans are griping and groaning and saying, you know, he was just a lanky, tall kid and grew up in Iowa, and this is a great story behind him. And a lot of people are griping that Gutekunst didn't get a better pick. But somebody on Twitter this morning had a great point. If this had been a Wisconsin Badger, people would say it was the greatest pick in the world. You know?
Oh, for sure. No doubt there's an element of the rivalry there, but
right?
I mean
think of that
position.
Think of this. What Richland Center kid, walk on at Wisconsin, end up being captain of the team. You know, if you had been drafted by the Packers in the first round, which of course you should have been, but if you'd been drafted in the first round, it would have been the greatest pick in the world.
Yeah, I don't know about that, but that would have been pretty darn cool. But
right?
to have an edge rusher or linebacker, I feel like, you know, he seems like more of a pass rush guy with good length and, mm-hmm. you know, good intangibles as far as measurables and all of that. I wouldn't say it's incredibly out of the norm for those guys to have a rotation. And as you look at, you know, I would characterize myself later in my career as a starter on offense, but mm-hmm. oftentimes I didn't get a technical start.
Right.
Because the first play of the offensive possession, you know, you wouldn't necessarily be on the field depending on what type of personnel you had out there for that first play. So there may be some aspect of that where, you know, he might not have started the first defensive play just because of the offensive personnel in those moments, but clearly a contributor. The Packers take a little bit different draft strategy too. You know, they
right.
are very much, everybody knows, very much developmental in nature. And, although I think he was highly touted in the NFL and coming out of the draft, I think he went a little bit earlier than some of the people had projected.
The Ryan Wood story in the Milwaukee Journal Sentinel said Gutekunst downplayed Van Ness's lack of college starts. In two seasons, Van Ness had close to 1,000 snaps. Gutekunst said he had 46.5 pressures, including six sacks last season. His 10.5 tackles for losses tied for the most of the Hawkeyes' defense. So, I think he's got to be a decent player. We shall see.
Time will tell, right?
Time, absolutely, time will tell. The draft is always interesting, right? Because, I mean, if you get it wrong, you're an idiot. But, boy, if you get that dark horse pick and it turns out great, you're the second coming of football.
That's right. Yeah, and no doubt a first-round pick gets a lot of opportunities. I mean, shoot, even myself as a fifth-round pick,
yeah,
through injuries and turmoil and different things, you get the benefit of the doubt for a couple years to see where things lie. And I'd say a first-round pick, while you have high expectations, going somewhere like the Packers is perfect.
Back after this, more Brady. He was at the Spring Badger football. We'll talk with him after that on the Todd Allball Show.
And a little bit of chicken fried. Cold beer on a Friday night. A pair of jeans that fit just right. And the radio
back to the Todd Allball Show. It is now 8:50 on a Friday. Not a Friday night quite yet, but close to it. April 28th, Friday 2023. Brady Ewing joins us on the phone live from Richland Center. Former Wisconsin Badger player, captain of the team, three-time Big Ten champion, and 3 years in the league for the Atlanta Falcons and the Jacksonville Jaguars. Joins us each and every Friday. We appreciate your time as always, Brady. Terrence Burkett, father of Miles Burkett, quarterback for the Badgers, tweeted this about an hour ago. Goody, as in Gutekunst, is in the driver's seat. Got an edge rusher on day one. By the way, they're hard to get and are big difference makers. Two picks on day two and plenty of tight ends and wide receivers left of the board. Lots of work to be done, but lots of chances to get something big. That's a good perspective, I think.
Yeah, it's interesting. I'm just interested to see what their plan is at wide receiver to continue to build some depth and talent there.
Yeah.
No doubt. I was surprised to see so many running backs. I think was there two or three running backs taken yesterday from what I recall. And there's so much depth at positions like running backs and wide receivers to where you can get quality picks, rounds two through five, six, seven. So
I can't
be interested to see how they add a depth there too.
Can you imagine, I forget the guy's name, but the first round pick for the Jets yesterday was a kid that went to high school at Waukesha North. And I said, can you imagine growing up in high school and watching Aaron Rodgers, and now you're going to play with him in New York? I mean, that blows my mind.
That's pretty cool, actually.
Right?
You had mentioned that in our text here this week, or yesterday evening, and so looked that up this morning. Yeah, Iowa State guy, I think, is where he went to school.
Yep, Iowa State.
And it seems like he had a great career. So it's just interesting to see guys from the state, too, where they end up, what types of careers they have. And now, like you said, growing up a Packer fan, now to be playing with Aaron Rodgers, that's got to be pretty surreal for that young man.
Right? It's just crazy. You were down in Madison here, you said a while back, looked in a little bit on the spring training. What are your takeaways? Did you get to meet Coach Fickell and talk with him at all, or Phil Longo? And what were your takeaways after watching some spring practice of the Wisconsin Badgers?
I did, yeah. I got the chance to go down and check out an early morning spring practice, and I thought it was good. A lot of energy in the McLean Center. This practice was indoors, and just a lot of energy, a lot of passion. Guys were flying around. Especially cool to see. It was actually on Tuesday morning early.
Wow.
And after the spring game, those guys are still out there practicing away, working hard. I did get a chance to talk to Fickell and Longo and meet them. Seemed like awesome guys. Impressed with both, but Phil Longo, we probably talked for 15, 20 minutes after practice.
Really? Wow.
I was picking on him for not having a fullback in his offensive scheme, and he broke it down for me on how, it's really, they can run a lot of the same stuff and, no doubt going to focus on throwing the ball a little bit more, but there's, depending on what type of defensive fronts are presented, it's going to give us a lot of flexibility to still be physical, still run the ball, have a tight end do some of the historic fullback stuff, And yeah, just an interesting perspective. He was a true ball coach in the way he kind of broke it down, and just, you know, honestly, you can do a lot of the same plays Wisconsin historically is known for, that doing out of the eye. You can run a lot of them out of 12 personnel or even 11 personnel if you have the right, you know, receiving core. So it'll be fun to see.
What's your takeaway, Brady, as a former player, a captain on the team, someone who worked for the team after you graduated, Badger through and through? I don't know anybody who bleeds a Cardinal white more than you. What is just your personal gut feeling after being around guys like Coach Alvarez and Coach Bielema and Coach Christ and on and on? And now looking at this program and Coach Leonard as well, I should mention, but now being around these guys for a little while, what's just your gut feeling as a Badger?
I love the, and I mean, you can feel what I've noticed, whether it's coming into school at Madison or from year to year coming back after, you know, spring, summer break, and you kind of have a transition in the team or going to the NFL, you immediately feel that culture and the energy of a team, you know, the camaraderie of a team. And what I saw on Tuesday is, you know, that seemed like it was at an all-time high in Madison. So I think you talk about how important culture is all the time, and as cliche as that sounds, I think it's really important. And we've talked about it before as far as those leaders and having multiple leaders on the team, and they're really trying to stress that. And I think that I felt that in what I saw. And also saw a lot of dang good athletes out there running around.
That's good.
You know, at receiver, it was really cool to see the depth at receiver, and, you know, defense was flying around. So it'll be Braylon Allen's looking as big as ever.
That's good news. Brady, we're going to play just a little bit of a clip here about we'll see how long we go on it here. I want to get your reactions to this question that was asked of Giannis Antetokounmpo after the Bucks lost this week.
Do you view this season as a failure?
Oh, my God. You asked me the same question last year, Eric. Okay. Do you get a promotion every year on your job? No, right? So every year you work is a failure. Yes or no? No. Every year you work towards something, towards a goal, right? Which is to get a promotion, to be able to take care of your family, to be able, I don't know. Provide a house for them or take care of your parents. You work towards a goal. It's not a failure. It's steps to success. Michael Jordan played 15 years, won 6 championships. The other 9 years was a failure? That's what you're telling me? No, I'm asking you a question. Yes or no?
No, I mean, I don't think so.
Okay, exactly. So why are you asking me that question? It's a wrong question. There's no failure in sports.
I love that. I love that response, Brady. About a minute and a half left. What do you take away from Giannis?
Absolutely love it. Gives me goosebumps hearing it. You know, that next day I had sent the clip over to my dad and my brother and others. Absolutely love that mindset. Some of the best athletes and people in the world that I've been around look at challenge and failure as an opportunity. And you hear it a lot out there, but to be able to do what professional athletes do at the highest level, you have to have a growth mindset where you're continuing to challenge yourself. And obviously you're controlling everything possible to put yourself and your team in a position to succeed at that level, or at least Giannis is. And I love that perspective. Giannis is so real, obviously emotional in that state coming off of a loss and the season being over. But love his, what a humble guy. And I think we can all learn something from that, whether we're a high school athlete, whether we're a college student, whether we're in the working world, whatever it may be. It's just there's so many learnings that come from that.
So very true. Brady Ewing, appreciate you as always, my friend. Have a great rest of your week. We'll talk to you in a couple. Brady Ewing, we always enjoy you. Have a great day.
Thanks, Todd.
My pleasure. Back with hour number 2 after this, including a giveaway of Milwaukee Brewer tickets. They're great seats, club-level seats. Don't miss it. Back after this on the Todd Wall Show. We'll be right back.